the King's Theatre in Edinburgh years and years ago. I'm sure in my late teens.
We'll always wear suits with a wee tie.
Yes, the red suit and the blue suit and the wee
catalogue. That's right.
Well, the two of them blend in very, very well.
They work. It was like a wee bit like that. That was it. The Glasgow-Dallas walk.
I'm coming to see a bit of comedy nostalgia, something that can never be replaced.
Skiing down the slopes at Davos, or skating in some old pond. We could be signing on the Riviera, reading about Jane Bond. We could be sailing on the most expensive Mediterranean cruise. But we're the boys who made the choice, and we'd rather be here with you.
Oh, Casablanca.
Oh, Hawaii.
Hong Kong.
Vienna.
Ardrossan.
We could be giving our regards to Broadway. You know the way people do. We don't like the whole life we need to know. So we gotta stay here. And we'd rather stay here. I'll be here with you.
Hey! Oh, come on in!
Come on out!
Come on in!
Come on out! Thank you very much indeed, ladies and what's the other kind?
Chinas.
May I just say how delightful we are for to be here tonight and have this opportunity of exposing ourselves to you. All right, Francie.
Sure, Josie.
And I must say, we're very indebted to Tom Mullarkey for digging us up for the Garden Festival.
Josie, we hope you haven't made a bloomer.
I do thank him from the bottom of my heart, and of course Francie's bottom also. Now, we've given considerable thought as to what we might...
Josie, I'm sorry to butt in now. I know it's not the right time, but I would like to ask you something very important.
What?
Have you got night starvation?
No. It's only people like George Galloway and Rowan Brown that get that.
Well, Josie, I've got it.
Have you?
And do you mind your pimple I got?
Where?
On my holidays. Josie, I was a wee bit worried about it.
Mm-hmm.
Thought it was something more than a simple pimple. Thought it might be something serious, like a pluck.
Huh?
And on top of that, I get terrible nightmares.
Ah, half dreamt about working, you know.
No! Josie, it's not about work I dream. I dream every night I'm eating food. For instance, all last night I dreamt I was eating spaghetti. Spaghetti all night long. I woke this morning.
What?
Nay, cord my pyjama trousers. And they fell down. What a sight. So, I went to the doctor, and he gave me a rummel hour with his periscope.
And what did the doctor say?
He was very definite. He said I had water on the brain.
Your brain dried up years ago, I wouldn't want to know.
Josie, it's true, he said I had water on the brain. What would you do for a thing like that?
Well, you could try a tap in the heat. Now, tonight, trainers, we thought we'd give you something in there.
Josie, no, we'll need to take this further.
Eh?
I'm not pleased with that answer.
Oh.
No, really. I just turn there and I give it a thought and I turn back and I says... It's just like that, you know. I hope the camera caught me. Now, how would you get a tap into my head?
Oh, Francie, it's very simple. You see, they would take you to Gap Naval. Gap Naval. And because you live round about these parts, they'd give you a local anaesthetic.
A local anaesthetic?
Local anaesthetic.
Never in your Auntie Nelly. If I'm going to have an operation, I'm going to the Bon Secours. And I'm going to demand twilight sleep.
Twilight sleep? Twilight sleep's only for labour.
There you are. Everything for labour, nothing for the Conservatives. And anyway, it's not possible. I couldn't go into hospital. Who's going to keep the house clean? If well, I win, who's going to keep the house clean?
The house couldn't get much dirtier.
That's not a nice thing to say. You know that my Auntie Jessie comes up right. She comes up regular.
Even,
well, often.
Even.
Noon and then. Once or twice. Oh, that'll be. And she keeps the house clean.
What does your Auntie Jessie do? What did she do the last time she was up? Rinsed out a milk carton. Emptied the ashes out the dresser drawer. Put them in the bureau drawer. Then sweep all the muck under the bed.
Well, we always sweep the muck under the bed.
But now it's getting serious. When I got out of my bed this morning, I bumped my head in the ceiling.
Here's a better idea, Josie. We'll get a strange woman into clean house. And that means that Auntie Jessie will devote all her time to nursing me.
What does your Auntie Jessie know about nursing?
She knows plenty.
Look at the last time you were ill. Remember that time
you had
the yellow jaundice?
I had jaundice. I had the yellow jaundice.
And there you were, lying in the bed in the kitchen. In the kitchen, all newly decorated in sunshine yellow.
Sure.
And your Auntie Jessie comes up and makes you put on a pair of yellow pyjamas.
What about it?
What about it? We couldn't find you for 3 days.
You passed the bed for 3 days and you never looked at me. I thought you were in the huff. You never tried to speak to me, Josie.
I couldn't even see you.
No, because I was all yellow.
You were all yellow.
I was all yellow.
Everything was yellow.
Everything was yellow.
Your Auntie Jessie's as stupid as you are. See, your Auntie Jessie's as stupid as you are when it comes to illness. Look at the time she was ill herself.
She was very ill.
Nothing wrong with her.
She was under the weather.
There was nothing wrong with her. She went to the doctor and the doctor examined her. He said it was nothing wrong with her. It was just a wee kind of minor infection.
A minor infection?
She was going to sue him.
How?
Said she'd never been near a pit of heat in her life.
Cos it's a wonderful thing to feel young and healthy. Great to see you're feeling fine. What do you care about being wealthy as long as you have a good time?
A man who wed at 95, a girl of 22.
Engaged a nice companion so his wife would not be blue.
We hear the wife is pregnant, the companion's pregnant too.
It's a wonderful thing to feel young.
Now an old man met a laddie crying boo hoo 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 hoo.
The boy said I'm upset cause I can't do what big boy do.
The old man thought a minute then he started crying too.
It's a wonderful thing to feel young. Cause it's a wonderful thing to feel full of youth pop. What if you've lost all your teeth? What if you find that there's snow on the rooftop? If there's a big fire underneath?
You've heard of Auntie Jessie now, it really is a farce.
She went out walking yesterday and fell upon the grass.
We promised not to mention where she stuck the last of blood.
It's a wonderful thing to feel young.
Now, Auntie Jessie's in a mess, you really mustn't scoff.
That plaster's really agony, especially when she coughs.
It didn't hurt when it went on, but jeez, when that come on.
It's a wonderful thing to feel young. Cause it's a wonderful thing to feel young and glowing. What if you've lost all your hair? What if you can't quite see where you're going, as long as you know when you're there?
A boy and girl caught winching underneath the stair he'd like.
Her father said, I'll teach you to make love to her this night.
The girl said, Dad, I wish you would, he can't, he did right.
Now, an old wife at a funeral called the minister by name.
She said, that man you've buried, he's 100, and the same.
He said, my God, 100, it's no worth your while to name.
It's a wonderful thing to feel young. Still, it's a wonderful thing to feel young.
I was just thinking the other day there, Francie, you know, I was walking through Nelson Mandela Place. You know where I'm?
I know where you are. It's just in the right there, up Bishop Tutu Lane.
Ah. Along Oliver Tambo Street. I was just thinking to myself there, you know, the changes that have taken place in Glasgow since we lived in the Cuckardens.
Oh, the Cuckardens. Oh, Josie, I loved... See, the Cuckardens, I loved living there.
Well, it was certainly better than where we are now.
Oh, I don't know. The Great Eastern Hotel's not all that bad. Running water.
Aye, doing the walls.
Aye, doing the walls.
No, there was nothing to compare with the Cuckardens. I mean, do you remember your Auntie Jessie's room and kitchen?
Oh, and especially her kitchen. Oh, what a smell.
Ah, well... She lived out of the slaughterhouse.
Oh, aye.
But you remember during the war, you remember during the war, when the first time she heard the sirens, she thought it was the German invasion.
Aye.
Stuck her head out the window with a big smile on her face. She says, when did the atrocities begin?
Yes, he loved the atrocities.
And Francie, the Cuckardens Labour Exchange.
Oh, the Baroo.
Oh, wow.
Oh, the Baroo. We used to sign on at box four.
That's right. All four eyes pying us out.
Aye, four eyes. Often wondered what happened to him, Josie.
Oh, he did awful well for himself. Aye, he's Secretary of State for Scotland now. And now, here's our tribute to the Garden Festival.
Thank you, Pat.
Sweet violets, sweeter than the roses, covered all over from head to toe, covered all over with sweet
violets.
Once was a lassie who lived in Lochgilly, and everyone knew that she had a big garden where flowers and weeds grew unbidden. In fact, it was often described as a haven for rabbits, the bugs and the bees, and traps would come in who were covered with wisdom and brought with them all sorts of junk. The smell that came out of them was worse than a sweet violet, sweeter than the rose.
Have a go, little pig girl.
Covered all over from head to toe. Covered all over with sweet violets.
Now in the next town lived a farmer named Sam. His farm and his farmhouse were not worth a tosser, except for a pretty young miss who worked as a milkmaid, and he liked to talk to and tell her why he felt a fool when he found that she had been milking the prophet and that he had made herself rich. He called her a strumpet, he called her a sweet violet.
Lovely.
He remembered the lass in Lochgilly. He thought of her lips and he thought of her parlour, where one day he knelt to propose. He said he would give her a ring for her finger and offer his heart as a gift. She got so excited she let off a firework to celebrate the wedding day from
most about the old times.
Josie, what's that?
The ballroom dance.
Oh, the jigging.
The jigging. I mean, in our day, when you went to ballroom dance, you know, you kept a hoddy of bird. Nowadays, when you finish a dance, you're facing some four-eyed git you've never seen in your life before.
I miss the jigging. I miss the Lacan on the plaza.
Oh, and the Dennis and Pally and the Albert just up the road for here.
Josie, the Albert. Oh, aye. And do you mind the protocol we went through before you could get a bird on the floor to dance?
Oh, I was there.
Carry on.
You used to walk round behind them and tap them in the elbow.
They never looked at you, never looked at you.
No.
She just walked down the middle of the flare there, turned round, Erin's up, ready to go.
Ah. you remember the last we used to have?
What was that?
You used to go round behind them, tapping them in the elbow and just stone there. They walk onto the floor, Erin's up, turned round, nobody done.
Is that wee sailor away again?
I don't think you should go in with
that. No, but not.
Listen, I'll tell you what. Well, let's give them a demonstration.
Sure, Josie.
Right. You be the bird.
Oh, no, I'm not being the bird.
Oh, come on, you be the bird.
You always make me the bird.
Well, you do it that well.
Well, I'll do it right. I'm not doing it tomorrow night.
No. Get a couple of birds in tomorrow night.
Sure. Get three in case one faints.
Right. Now, you... Now, as you enter the dancing establishment, you will perceive that all the spare birds is hanging up against the wall. And this one's left their engine running. And then comes the formal approach. Fair midden. Would you scare for a gyratory convolution or burrow in the hall?
Huh?
Are you dancing?
You asking?
I'm asking.
Dance.
Do you come here often?
No, just every night.
It's a rare band, isn't it?
Oh, it's a rare band. I sent a request to the drummer.
Now, what did he say?
Beat it.
Anybody ever tell you you dance like Sid Charisse?
No.
I'm no surprised.
I'll have you know I've got dancing in my blood.
It's a pity it hasn't got down to your feet yet. Oh, what's that?
That's a new one, that's the Prince Philip.
Oh. Well, what's that?
That's a hitchhiker. Oh. What's
What's that?
Trousers coming down.
It's a rare flair, isn't it? Wish you'd get off my feet and try for yourself.
You know something?
No.
You're one in a million.
So is your chances. See that miss, I just met him 5 minutes ago. He said that already. You just watch yourself.
Anybody seen you him?
See myself him?
Don't fancy your job.
Watch yourself. Look, get fresh. There's a nerve in your arm right
down your horn. And I know where it's finishing. Now you
watch that.
I'll call for help. Oh, I don't need any help.
Right.
Have you not got a lumber?
No.
Where do you stay?
East Kilbride.
East Kilbride? Mm. It's no a lumber you want, it's a pen pal.
Beginning to miss it. Do you know something? See, last week, every night last week, I had a different fella see me home. Sure, that was a feather in my cap.
Oh, definitely a feather in your cap, aye.
And you see, in the summer here, I won the talent contest. Sure, that was another feather in my cap.
Oh, definitely another feather.
See, last night, I won the talent contest.
Did you?
Yes, for the spot waltz. Sure, that was another feather in my cap.
Oh, definitely another feather.
I had near spots than any other woman. Hey, stop the bond. Look at the time. Look at the time. I've missed my last bus. How am I going to get home?
Use your bloody feathers and fly home. Just think there, you know, the last time we were got up like this, you know, we were in Edinburgh.
If you're right, Josie. Oh, that's a lovely city, Josie, Edinburgh.
Oh, it's all right.
Oh, it's nice. No, it's nice, Josie. No.
Yeah, it's a very hysterical city, of course.
Sure is, sure is.
Remember we went to see all the sights? We went down to Holyrood Palace there, into Mary Queen of Scots' bedroom.
Oh, what a bedroom.
Oh, wow.
See that Mary Queen of Scots' bedroom? Who did it? One Pierre Barrett.
I think that would be McDonald's, would it not?
McDonald's, aye. Oh, here, mind, see that Mary Queen of Scots? I meant to ask you about that. What was that big plaque that was in the middle of the flare there?
Well, that was where Rizzio fell.
I got no surprise, I nearly tripped out at myself. I nearly went my elk to be on. Don's dangerous, it should have a wee sign, watch plaque. Yeah. Plaque must be watched.
No, that's got all to do with events that took place in the 16th century.
Sure, Josie, 16th century.
Ah.
Was that AD or BC?
Oh, well, don't be stupid. They didn't have electricity in these days.
See, Josie knows.
You see, Rizzio was an Italian.
Sure.
And they murdered him.
Didn't he fancy his ice cream?
No.
Or corn flour.
No, there was a rift in the royal household.
Must have been his hot peas then.
Very dangerous.
Nothing to do with his hot peas.
No, no.
Look, you saw the bed there. Remember the bed?
Lovely bed, lovely bed.
No less than 6 Scottish kings and queens have slept in that bed.
6? In the one bed?
They weren't there all the time. I mean, just every noon again for bed and breakfast.
B and B.
If you wanted to be cold in the morning, you left your window.
You haven't done that for a long time. No.
You don't think I should have bothered? No.
We did that 20 years ago.
Listen, I'll tell you about the bed. I'll tell you about the
bed. If you want to be cold in the morning. Tell them about it.
Now, think about the bed.
I'm thinking about the bed now.
Right.
What a bed.
One night.
Yes.
It was very dark.
Sure.
And very stormy.
Sure.
And Mary, Queen of Scots, was having a kip in that bed.
She was having a what?
A kip.
A kip.
A doss. She had her head down.
Oh, she'd taken a peel.
Oh, but ridiculous. The pill hadn't been invented yet. They just used suits of armour and chainmail and all that.
Oh, it'd be a big running brassle.
What a night it was.
Well, it must have been
a terrible night. Oh,
with a chainmail.
The thunder was rolling across the heavens.
Sure, sure.
And the lightning was flashing. Mm. And the rain was bucketing down.
Mm. Glasgow fair fortnight. Stunning at Gura.
Suddenly, Rizzio came in.
Yes.
And they were all waiting for him.
Oh.
And they jumped on him.
Oh.
And they stabbed him all over his body.
That wouldn't help his lumbago.
No.
No.
And there he was, poor soul.
Yes.
Lying there, totally dead, in her chamber.
He must have been a midget.
He was off his head when he came into her chamber.
Ah, he was a wee bit potty at the time.
He was a wee bit potty.
Potty chamber.
And ever since then,
right,
he has roamed Holyrood Palace, a desperate and dangerous spirit.
Like Lanlick?
No.
A bottle of that and you're heeding the ball.
Oh, no. He's a ghost, I'm telling you.
He's a ghost.
I'm talking about ghosts.
Oh, wait, don't be so stupid, Josie. Ghosts are not such thing. Nobody believes in ghosts. They're not such thing.
Of course people believe in ghosts. A lot of people believe in ghosts.
Like who?
Well, look at your actual spiritualists.
Oh, that's up to them.
Well, they believe in ghosts.
Do they?
Look at Big Bella McGovern. She's a great spiritualist. She's a going to spiritualist meetings. I mean, Bella will go to a spiritualist meeting any time she's out for the messages.
That's a good one, Josie.
What?
Out for the messages. That's a stoter.
What's a stoter?
What you said now. You know,
what did I say?
You said the spiritualist. You know, did you not mean to say it? I thought you meant to say it. I thought it was funny. Just the way you come out with it.
Come out with what?
Oh, you know, maybe it just slipped through. Do you know me to say it? It was funny. You said Bella McGovern goes to a spiritualist meeting any time she's out for the messages. Well, you know how you get a message when you go to a spiritualist meeting? Do you not see it?
Oh, no. Bella gets her messages for the cold.
I'm talking it just the way you said it. Maybe you didn't mean to, but it was funny. You said Bella McGovern goes to a spiritualist meeting any time she's out for the message. Well, you know how folk go to a spiritualist meeting to get a message? You don't see a message.
Are you trying to tell me people go to a spiritualist meeting and say, give us a pun of sausages now?
No! It's no eating stuff. No eating it's messages from outer space. You stood there. Aye. And you said, Bella, what did you say again? Bella McGovern. It was funny, wasn't it? I thought, okay, it doesn't matter, just carry on. Maybe it wasn't so funny after all. Doesn't matter.
Well, anyway, what I was going to tell you. See, Bella went to this spiritual speech one night.
He's got it. He's got it.
You've been the spiritualist, hold the spiritualist meeting in the coal.
No! Forget the coal. I went to the safeware somewhere. You stood there and you said, Bella McGovern. She goes, she gets a message. Oh, it is, you owe me a story.
I don't think about the less funny it is.
Well, anyway, Bella went to this spiritualist meeting.
Yeah,
this particular night, he said, to get in touch with our dear departed husband, wee Shuey.
Shuey.
And they were all sitting around this big table, hodding horns, you see. Aye. And the wee woman who was hodding the seongs.
Oh, the what?
The seongs. She was laughing her head off, you know. She was laughing. It was really quite funny. Laughing her head off.
What was so funny?
Oh, there was nothing funny. She was just a happy medium. Suddenly, this trumpet floated.
Wait a minute, don't get any further, Josie.
What?
We've stood for enough. Who ever heard of a trumpet at a spiritualist meeting?
You can have a trumpet if you want it, it's voluntary. And suddenly, this trumpet spoke.
Spoke?
This was wee Shuey.
Shuey the trumpet?
Ah, talking in B flat. And Bella looked up, she said, is that you, Shuey? And Shuey said, aye, it's me, Bella. And she said, are you happy there? Oh, he said, it's marvellous here. Oh. He said, the sky is so blue and the grass is so green and everything's so peaceful and quiet. She says, do you like being an angel in heaven? Oh, he said, I'm no an angel in heaven. I'm a coup in a field of metal.
I'm a coup in a field of metal. A coup in a field of metal.
Stupid looking big Egypt.
What?
I have never heard such a load of rubbish in all my life. Who ever heard of anybody ever coming back as a coo?
Of course people come back as coos.
Do they?
Where else do you think they get the reincarnation milk from?
You'll be right enough, Josie knows. And now I'm going to sing you, Chinas, a song which is one of Josie's most, probably one of his most loveliest compositions. This song tells the immoral story of a young boy and a young girl who went to Bonklin. Bonklin, it's between here and Large, you know. If you go to the Anderson bus station, you'll get a bus all the way to Bonklin. Well, they went to Bonklin for a picnic. And they were sitting in the grass there and they had that lovely fresh cherries. And this lassie was getting chowed into a cherry. When inadvertently, it was ejaculated from her gob, her mouth, and it landed on her lap, on her dress, and she looked into her lover's eyes, and his eyes met hers. And at that moment, the poor soul, he couldn't help it, but he rifted. And he knew he had rifted. And she knew he had drifted too. But she wasn't that worried because the wind was blowing in the right direction, you know. And it's when their eyes met, they realized that their love was well and truly constipated. My love, she was a hairy. Her name was Joan. I gave my love a cherry, complete with stone. My love, she dropped her cherry upon her dress. A cherry on a hairy makes such a mess. Do cherry stains come out? She cried in fear. Do cherry stains come out? Oh, tell me, dear, I hope the stage come out. He answered, fine, I hope the stage come out. I've swallowed my... Tiders! Going to see something that's really worth coming in here tonight for and sitting down. Because I hope you're all sitting down. Because my big pal Josie is going to come on here in person on this platform. Himself in his best jacket. And he's going to sit at that Joanna there and he's going to play. We're not very sure what he's going to play. But whatever tune he plays, it will be one of the nicest tunes that's ever been rotten. And you can't beat Josie for playing rotten tunes. Take it away, Josie. On the name of...
That's not too drafty for you, is it?
Big fella that. Seems quite a nice lad too. Here, has anyone seen my pal Josephine? She's my pal in the beats. Nice to have a companion. Of course, I didn't start in the police force in Glasgow. I started up in the Highlands. And you know, the first night I arrived there, to pass the night, I went to their bingo and they call the numbers out in Gaelic. Gaelic! That's so the visitors can't win. I'm sitting there with my card and the caller shouting, hoher, hoher, hachen. Here a hachen, hoch rachen. happened? Heery, heery. I was clickety-click, I found out late. And the woman next to me had a full hoose. She shouted, hocker, hocker, harach, anach, and hoose. When I was up there, they were building these electric pylons. And this old Highland lady spoke to me. She said, Polish woman, if I put my foot near one of the pylons, will I get a shock? I said, madam, you certainly will, if you can manage to get your other foot to touch the overhead wire. You know, the new Polish home was built at the time, and I was billeted in the farmhouse. I was with a charming couple. It was a farmer and his wife, a young couple, and they were expecting their first happy event. As a matter of fact, I was there when the baby was born. I'll tell you all about it. Your pleasure. O'Hone and O'Hee. One night just after tea, he was sitting scraping shuck free half his wellies, oh. The wife with smile sublime said, Joan, I think it's time. Half and half a funny feeling in my belly, oh. So he ran doon to the doctor in the toon, and signed with excitement that he dare nae show. He held the lamb and the doctor Sunday gam, and he produced the first and only bairnie, oh. Now take the lamb and wash the spry young scamp, but bring me back the lamb and give the Mary go. He brought the lamb, he said, Johnny, you're a champ, you're the father of another body bairnie, oh. Now take the lamb and wash the spry young scamp, but bring me back the lamb and give the Mary go. When he got back, he said, Johnny, you've the knack, you're the father of another bonny bairnie, oh. When it got to number six, he was really in a fix. He was washing lamps and trying to lick the bairnies, oh. The doctor, he said, heavens, knew we've come to number seven. I have never seen so many bonny bairnies, oh. Now take the lamp and wash this braw young scamp, but bring me back the lamp and give them here, you know. He said, I'll wash this braw young scamp, but I'm bringing back nae lamp. It's the lick that is attracting all the babies. Joseph,
you know,
I'm hanging about here all the time waiting for you. You're
oh,
awful late.
Francie, with a hell of a stramash being in Duckett.
Josephine, why?
Well, there's this wee woman in buying a new pair of shoes.
Aye.
And the wee man that was attending her had a completely baldy heap. Oh. And when he knelt down to try on the shoes, she looked down, saw the baldy heap, and she thought her knee was through her stoking. So she just pulled her skirt out of it.
I don't get it.
No, but she did when he lit a match to see where he was. Has there been anything happening?
Nothing's happened at all.
No, no.
It's the quietest it's been for months.
Oh, that's nice. It gives you a chance to settle into the job.
Oh, wow.
I love being at the polls. I really love being at the polls. I mean, if you see a fella you fancy, you can just lift him.
Oh, I love the polls force too, Josephine. I very nearly didn't giant.
Oh, for why did you very nearly didn't giant?
Well, that medical inspection, that was disgraceful. This doctor made me take all my clays off. Every stitch is done near the scud.
Oh, your clays off?
Yes.
You were lucky.
Lucky.
My doctor didn't even ask me to take my gloves off.
Well, I had a thorough doctor.
Oh, did you?
The only trouble was, our horns were off a cold.
Our horns?
She had horns.
Wait a minute, a woman doctor?
Aye.
Oh, to hell with that.
Oh! And on top of that, the other thing was the intelligence test.
They gave you an intelligence test?
They certainly did.
And did they find only?
Of course they did. Dressless.
Oh, I don't know.
They did. It was the questions.
What was the matter with the questions?
Eh, nothing wrong with it, just what they asked me.
What?
This big sergeant said, "Madam, come over here. What's the distance between Glasgow and Dundee?" I said, "Here, if that's the length of beat, to hell with the job." Oh. You like Dundee?
Oh, I know the things they do. A big sergeant took me outside in the dark one night and said, "Your beat's the heat of that red light over there." I was away for 3 weeks.
3 weeks? What's up?
Well, the red light was in the lorry going to Inverness.
That was good going 3 weeks to Inverness. I hate these tough districts. This is a tough district.
Oh, it's a tough district.
Do you remember about a month ago they put that poster outside the police office? Man wanted for murder.
Uh-huh.
Six fellas applied for the job.
Oh.
There.
All right, enough. The other day I was stoating down the road and this fella jumped out a shop doorway at me and whipped open his raincoat. What a shock I got.
What was wrong?
He was selling matches.
And Josephine doesn't smoke.
I know. And I'm all electric at home. Anyway, I arrested him for being a solicitor, you know?
Quite right.
And we're stood along the road. We passed this tobacconist shop. He said, "I wonder if you'd hang on here while I go in for some fags."
Oh.
I said, "Oh, that's a likely thing." I said, "You're in for the fags away out the back door, I'll never see you again." And I said, "I'm no just as stupid as all that." I said, "You stand here and I'll go for the fags."
Oh, do you know I was called out late last night? Oh, it was a big carry-on. This man's wooden leg was hurting him.
His wooden leg was hurting?
Ah, his wife was hitting him out of the head with it.
That's funny, I was called out last night too.
Were you?
Somebody complained there was an awful smell of chips coming from the monastery.
Chips from the monastery?
Chips from the monastery. Oh. So I went away up to investigate. Right, yes. Now, here's this big monk. Stoning there with a big pot of chips. What a pot of chips he had sizzling away there.
He'd be the friar.
He was
the...
No, as a matter of fact, he was a chipmunk.
Funny you should mention the monastery.
Really? Is that your next line?
I nearly forgot it there. Doesn't matter. It's being edited. Listen. Talking about...
Somebody else said that was wrong.
Oh, yeah. Well... Talking about the monastery,
yes.
That reminds me, you know our friend Willie McClumpher?
Willie McClumpher,
ah. Oh, yes, you know him. He drives that van for Frankie's Manky Laundry.
That's right.
Well, he was sacked last week. He got the sack last week.
No, what for?
Oh, it was his fault. He went up to the monastery. He said to the head monk, "Have you any dirty habits?" Any dirty habits? How stupid can you get?
That is a shame, that.
How is that?
Well, he was putting his boy through the university.
Oh, that's a fine boy.
Oh, 18. He's a clever boy.
Oh, he's got brains, that
clever.
Boy.
He's going to be a metallurgist, you know.
Oh, do you credit that?
Oh, a clever boy.
Well, he'll be it.
Yes.
Whatever it is, he'll be it.
How many metallurgists about, you know?
There is not.
And he's going to be one.
What's a metallurgist?
You know what a metallurgist is? Everybody knows what a metallurgist is. I mean, it's a thing that I mean, if you were, I mean, you've got to go through the university, and you've got to read about it, and then you graduate and you're one, and then you would. You would how? I mean, if you were walking along the road, you know, if you're walking along and you saw one of these, for the fellas sitting there and smoking, play cards, one of these things in the middle of the road, and if you, well, let me put it another way. Supposing you see, if you went on where there's a building, you know, with a lot of. You know how they dig and where there's, you know, I don't know what the hell it is.
You didn't mind me asking.
Not at all. You'll never learn anything if you don't
ask. You're quite right. But you see that boy? Oh, he's a big boy for his age.
Oh, he's a big boy.
What a size of a boy. I'll tell you, when I discovered this, he was having this lovely Sunday morning swim in the Mullen Diner.
Oh.
And he was in there without a costume. He didn't swim with costume. He was in the scud. There was nobody hanging about, so he just took his clothes out, and they were lying in a big heap, and I passed this heap of clothes, and I happened to look at the water, and as I looked at the water, he was coming out. Oh, what a size of a boy. And he was that embarrassed when he saw me. He just grabbed his cap to cover his embarrassment, you know.
Uh-huh.
Oh, my God, Josephine. He could have done with a bigger cap. And I'm standing here. I couldn't help laughing. And when he was livid, he was mad. He said, "You're no lady or you wouldn't laugh." I said, "You're no gentleman or you'd lift your hat." Never seen him since. It was a waste of time.
Because the young folk nowadays, you know, they don't get the parental guidance that we used to get.
Quite right.
I remember my mammy always saying to me, she says, "Josephine, she says, you watch these men, watch these men. They're only after one thing." I said, "Don't you worry, mammy, I've got it up here." Oh. She says, "It doesn't matter where you've got it, they'll find it."
Good, Josephine. Oh. Well found sense. That'll be it, no.
But you know, you're quite right about these young people.
Oh,
when you think of it, you sensibly think about it.
Yeah.
You know. Especially these young lassies. They're going about and they're smoking, they're drinking, going to be a different fella every night, and they're having wains without getting married. My God, I wish I'd off their luck. Do you mind me, Sandra McGuffey?
Sandra McGuffey?
I mind that she kind of had a hairy face.
Oh, a wee hairy face, I remember
she had a wane last week.
She did?
Yes. Was born with a moustache.
Oh. Born with a moustache? What did she have to say about that?
Oh, she was tickled to death.
Because I've been doing a wee bit of whinge to myself, you know?
Oh, we've heard all about it, you and Big Sergeant Purdy. It's all in the polo's office.
Took me out to Drimmin last Sunday in the car. And you know what happened? We ran out of water.
Well, that's a new year.
Right. So we up to the Buchanan Arms Hotel and he come back with a big bucket of water and he filled up the radiator. You know, he had quite a lot of water left over, so he just bunged it out of a hedge. Well, this man stood up, soaked to the skin he was, and a language. Oh. You've never heard language like that in all your life. I didn't know half the words. And Big Purdy says, here, he says, "Do you mind? I happen to have a lady with me."
Quite right.
This fella says, "What the hell do you think? I've got a duck."
We are the backbone of the polis force. We are the Glasgow polis bells. But if you ever need the law, of course we'd rather you got someone else. If we see a man we fancy, though he's doing nothing wrong,
We run him in.
It is the only thing to do.
We run him in.
If you were us, well, wouldn't you? And every night when it gets black, we find a car that's parked somewhere. We curl ourselves up in the back and have a snooze right then and there. And if we don't wake up till morning, when the driver goes to work,
He runs us in.
It's really most embarrassing.
We have a goal.
They never know.
We're right as rain.
They can't complain.
We are the backbone of the law.
This song tells the story of a woman
who wanted to spend one night at this lovely country hotel. So she went to the manager. She said, have you a single room for tonight? He said, madam, I'm very sorry, but the hotel is full. Oh, she said, don't say it's full. Oh, he says, it's full, full, full. It's not only full, it's full. Oh, she said, I've always wanted to spend one night at this lovely hotel. He said, well, I'll accommodate you if you don't mind sharing a twin-bedded room with a commercial traveller. She kind of gave him a funny look, you know. I mean, he said, it's all right, madam, everything's above board. I'll see there's a blanket tied between the two beds and you won't know what's happening on the other side. She said, fair enough. So up she went to the bedroom and she found that the commercial traveller was already in his bed. And she was standing there a bit worried about this commercial traveller. In case he did a bit of travelling through the night, you know. With his samples. So. She looked over the blanket, but she could see he was a perfect gentleman. He was lying in the bed there with his gloves on. And his bowler was under the bed. So she got ready for her bed. She thought, he's a lovely gentleman. I'd love to get to know him better. So she used her womanly guile. And this is the commercial traveller's story of what happened that night in the twin-bedded room in the country hotel. Your pleasure. Last night, she came to me as I lay in my bed. She pulled down the bedclothes and softly she said, I'm that bloomin' thirsty and you're near the sink. Would you get me some water? I fear need a drink. So I go to the water, got back to my bed. Then she tugged at the bedclothes and sweetly she said, I'm lying here sweating, I can't breathe at all. Would you open that windy and give me a blow? So I opened the windy, got back to my bed. I was just dozing off when she called me again. I'm lying here chittering beneath the bedclothes. Would you please shut that windy? I'm blooming near froze. So I looked at her smiling as she lay in her bed. Says I, would you like to pretend we are wed? She coyly replied, yes I would. I said, well, you can bloody well shut the damn window yourself.
Thank you very much, Dennis. Now, we'd like to sing a wee song which some of you may remember. It's called La-di-da-di-da. La-di-da-di-da.
And, Thank you, Dennis.
I think that's the publisher's in. Now, I got the idea for this song many, many years ago when I read in the paper about a case of a young man being had up in court for molestating a young lady. And just before the trial started, the judge said, now, he said, this is a very serious case. He said, I think we'll hold this case in camera. And the young man said, excuse me, Your Worship. He says, what does that mean, in camera? And the judge said, well, I know what it means. And the clerk of the court knows what it means. And the ladies and gentlemen of the jury know what it means. And if you'd been there when they were on Newt Brains, you would have known what it meant. He said, right, get into the dock and just tell us in your own words exactly what happened. So the young man said, well, he said, Your Worship, it was like this. I was taking this young lady home from a dance, and we had to cross this big field. And right in the middle of the field, I was suddenly overcame with passion. And I kissed her, full in the mouth. And after that, it was just all la-di-da-di-da. The judge said, just a minute. He said, what does that mean, la-di-da-di-da? And the young man said, well, I know what it means. And the clerk of the court knows what it means. And the ladies and gentlemen of the jury know what it means. And if you'd been there with your bloody camera, you would have known it.
Good, Josie. I just thought that. Actually, this song, Josie, tells about this man. He'd enough a big nose.
Oh, a great big conky.
Oh, but the size of a snitch.
Oh, what a hooter he had. Oh. Thank you, Pat.
On the 17th of March in La-di-da-di-da, a son was born to Mrs. Daddy Dum. He had two arms, two legs, a nose, a mouth, an eye, and the usual la-di-da-di-da. So they duly christened him la-di-da-di-da, and gave his second name as Daddy Dum. And throughout his life, and he lived for 90 years, he was known as la-di-da-di-da. Now as he grew up, his la-di-da-di-da grew quicker than his other dum-dee-dum. And when he was 15, everyone remarked on his great big la-di-da-di-da. Now he met a girl in la-di-da-di-da. She was pretty, though a little dandy-dum. But the reason that he loved her best was she didn't mind it la-di-da-di-da. Her mother was awfully la-di-da-di-da. Her father was completely da-di-dum. They sat down to dinner of salmon mayonnaise and a bowl of la-di-da-di-da. Now it all went well till la-di-da-di-da he bent to take a bite of da-di-dum. He cut his plate and the salmon mayonnaise fell upon his la-di-da-di-da. Her mother cried loudly, la-di-da-di-da. Her father sort of mumbled, da-di-dum. Her mother said, dear, you must try to find a boy with a smaller la-di-da-di-da. But they married in the spring of la-di-da-di-da and honeymooned in lovely da-di-dum. Then they found that they couldn't get in the double bed for his great big la-di-da-di-da. And so they decided la-di-da-di-da to use two single beds for da-di-dum. They slept together and they used the other one just to rest his la-di-da-di-da. On the 19th of June in la-di-da-di-da he took ill with an attack of da-di-dum. They wrapped him up in bandages, they ended with a bow, Rooney's la-di-da-di-da-di-dum. He died on the morning of la-di-da-di-da, a victim of the dreaded da-di-dum. They placed him in his coffin, but they couldn't shut the lid for his favorite la-di-da-di-da-di-dum. So the undertaker, la-di-da-di-da, decided on a plan for da-di-dum. He made another coffin, roughly 3 feet 2 by 1, just to take his la-di-da-di-da-di-dum. Now you're in on his tombstone, la-di-da-di-da, the son of la-di-da-di-da-di-dum. Here lies his body, and in the next grave up but one, lies his la-di-da-di-da-di-da-di-dum.
Tell him a joke. Come on, keep it going. Tell him a joke.
I don't know any jokes you can tell in front of people.
Ah, Josie, no plenty. Well, tell the one I reminded you last week. Tell them the one about our bros.
Oh,
our brother.
How does that go again?
Remember, I reminded you last week. There was this chap, and he chapped at the door. And he said to the chap, the answer to the chap at the door, is your sister in?
Why?
Oh,
that's his daughter.
He tells it marvellous, he hears.
There was this chap. And he was a plumber.
Hey, where? Who said he was a plumber? Who said anything about a plumber?
Well, you just said the fella said, how's your system?
Oh, I never said system. I said, the chap says it's your sister in. Not the day we are plumber. Well, your sister.
Plumber's no there.
Plumber's no there.
Oh. Plumber's no there. Right.
is your sister in? He tells it marvellous.
There was this chap at the door, you see, and this fella said, pardon me, is your sister in?
Well, so, wait a minute, I've made a mistake, it's not a sister, hang on. No, it's not a sister, definitely not a sister.
Is your sister not there either?
No. This chap.
He's maybe away looking for the plumber.
You made a fool of this joke. Can you me? Should have remembered, same as myself. What? It's no, it can't be a sister. It's got to be a granny.
A granny?
That's it, a granny.
A granny.
It's this chap, he chapped the door, and he says to the chap, answer the chap the door, is your granny. He's got it now. Yeah. He tells it marvellous.
But it's all the same to you, we'll go to another street.
There was this
chap at the door, you see, and...
There's actually two chaps. Eh? Two chaps. And don't let that worry you.
This fella knocked twice at this door.
No! What are you talking about? I didn't knock twice, you only knocked once.
You just said there was two chaps.
I know, that's because there was a chap chapped at the door. And there was another chap that entered the chap at the door. One door, two chaps, one door. I've never seen him like this before, and he tells it marvellous too.
There was all these fellas at this door. And they were looking for this fella's sister who'd run away with a plumber. This fella said, well, I don't know. He said, the last time I saw the plumber, he was away down the road with a tin of harpic. We thought he was going round the bend.
Talking about away around the bed, a plumber. What? Is that the joke? That's not the joke. The joke is there was this chap, and he chapped at the door, and he says to this chap, answer the chap at the door, is your sister in? No, oh. It's your granny in.
Ah, it's you. You mucked it up a noise.
The sister.
Ah.
Nothing to do with sister.
Sister's not there.
It's got to be a granny.
It's got to be a granny.
Now remember that. So he said, is your granny in?
Yes.
And he said, no. No.
No.
She's at our broth. He said, don't you worry, I'll come in and wait till she's finished. He thought she was having a plate of soup. He's got it now, he tells it marvellous.
There was this chap at the door, and this fella said, pardon me, has your granny finished her soup yet? and this fella said, no, he said, no matter of fact, we couldn't get the can open, we've lost the tin opener. And this fella said, well, don't worry yourself. He says, I'm going to your broth and I'll pick one up for you the way you do.
What are you talking about? This fella's ever been to your broth. He's not a broth. He doesn't even know where our broth is. There's only one person at broth. That's a granny. You remember that. Granny a broth. A broth granny. Granny a broth. Never seen this before and he tells it marvellous to you.
Not to confuse you. Right. It's actually the granny who... What does she have to go to your broth for a plate of soup for?
That's the joke. She wasn't having soup.
Oh, she wasn't having... Oh, there's no soup.
No soup.
Oh, the soup's are.
Soup's are.
Soup's are. No, she's on the mince and toys now. And she likes mince because it's half-chowed before you start, you know what I mean? When she's got everything in there, she's got the sweet turned up, the big man of fat peas, and the doughboys, the big dot of white bread sucking up the brown gravy that's good brown and mushy and it's running down her chin into her chemise. What a
thing
to get into this old woman.
Chemise! Will you get to this poor old woman? You're making a right fool of this old woman. She needs chemise. No. And she wasn't having sweet turnip. Or a mince and totties. Or dods of brown bread soaking up the brown gravy. Nor soup.
Oh, it was nor soup. Well, I thought it was crossing Black Welshes.
Josie, when I say North soup, I mean she wasn't having any soup. The old woman was at her brood, but she was having nothing. Nothing! She was there, her brood, nothing. Not even a parliament.
You trying to tell me that poor old woman's away to her brood with no even a sandwich?
Yes. Because that's the joke. There was this chap at the door. And he said to this chap, answer the chap at the door, is your granny in? He said, no, she's at her brood. He said, don't worry, I'll come in and wait until she's finished. See? He thought she was having a big bowl of broth. We are ham shank in it.
That is a stupid joke.
No.
That is the stupidest joke I've ever heard in my life. Doesn't it make sense? I mean, there's no logic about it. The woman's either her brother, she's not her brother, she's having a...
He's got a
I don't get that.
So long, it's been good to know you. So long, it's been good to know you. So long, it's been good to know you. But we gotta be drifting along. May we say thank you. It's been great to be here. Thank you. It's been great to be here. So long, it's been good to know you. But we gotta be drifting along.
Tell you, you dance like Sid Charisse.
No.
I'm no surprised.
I'll have you know I've got dancing in my blood.
Ah, it's a pity it hasn't got down to your feet yet. Well, what's that?
That's a new one. That's the Prince Philip.
Oh. Well, what's that?
That's a hitchhiker. That?
Trousers coming down.
Jack and I came together in 1960.
We teamed up for the 8:05, and that was in the King's in Edinburgh. Rikki was going to do the summer show, and he saw me a year before that, and he said, would you like to join me for a... the 8:05 show, and I says, yeah, that would be marvellous.
We discovered this quite incredible rapport. It's a kind of a Joyous thing?
It was a variety show, you know, the 8:05, music and song and dance, and then every programme we did a sketch, and that was Francie and Josie.
We both seemed to delight in working together, and things which had only been moderately funny before were suddenly great belly laughs. The roof was coming off.
So he said, now we'll wear the teddy boy suits. The teddy boy suits. And in these days it was the velvet collar and the short trousers, just as we've got now, except we don't have the velvet collars. But Rikki said, no, you'll need a wig. So he had a lot of spare wigs in a cupboard. So he came out with all but a dozen of them, and I tried them all. He eventually came across this Frankenstein wig, you know, and it's cut straight across, and I said, that's it. That's it. Right away, and I said, aye, that's awful funny, that. And his was a black one, and you did a wee curl on at the top, you know.
And the two characters came alive and became loved.
It just was, clicked right from the start.
Then when we put them on television very shortly after, I think it was a couple of years later, they appeared on television, and they were an immediate smash hit, because it didn't seem to matter where we did this thing or under what circumstances.
Could be on the course at Old St. Andrews, sinking the holes at par. We could be down in some old Latin nightclub, dancing the cha-cha-cha. We could be heading down a Paris Black Street, making for some rendezvous. But place your bets with no regrets, cause we'd rather be here with you.
I wasn't in Glasgow when they went out. I was on holiday, and I came back about 3 weeks later in London, and the funny thing is I met Rikki, and he was down in London too, but he had already been staying in Glasgow when they went out, the first three. So he said to me in London, that's funny meeting you, how do you have a nice holiday on that? He said, have you been to Glasgow? I said, no, I've been away on holiday. He says, you won't believe what's happened. I said, what do you mean? He said, I won't say anything about it, but he said, I'll just let you find out for yourself. So about a week later, I stayed in London for a week and saw some shows then. I remember vividly coming back to Glasgow, and when I started, went in for petrol, they were all shouting, oh, hello China, how's it going? And I couldn't believe it, and all the kids coming out of school, and these days, of course, it was a long while ago, they had school bags at the back, you know, with the straps, and they were all doing the Francie and Josie walk, and they were throwing stones at the window where I lived as Francie, and it was ridiculous. So it was an immediate success, that was it. And we didn't realise how big it was. And then, when we realised how big it was actually, we were playing this theatre for a 8:05 show.
We both remember arriving here on the morning, first morning of rehearsal, and there was this enormous queue, and we'll never forget that queue way down the street, the way around into Newton Street, which no longer exists. And in fact, we always used to go for a cup of coffee to a wee cafe across in Sucky Hall Street. And very often I discovered Jack crossing Sucky Hall Street as I was driving up. And we used to do terrible things, you know, like I would drive up at speed, slam the brakes on him, a great squealer brake, and nearly knock him down and toot the horn. And he would stand in the middle of the road cursing and swearing at this driver, you know. And of course people would stop, in the name of God, what's happening? Oh, do you see who it is, you know? And however, our greatest surprise was to see this queue.
The queues were right down from the box office right down to the Mitchell Library. Two deep, four deep. We knew then that the power of television. You see, we were known on the stage, but with just the theatre audiences, but everybody then knew us from outside of all the little villages, towns. They all came scrambling in to see Francie and Josie on the stage. This was the most amazing thing.
I think the characters of Francie and Josie are perhaps initially dictated by the scripts we were using.
There were just like so many, many, many lads in Glasgow in these days who were sort of walking about. The fly men, we used to call them.
Josie would appear to be the knowledgeable one. He had all the genius. In fact, I can remember him even explaining, and it was always off the cuff too, which sometimes got a bit difficult, because Milroy would throw things at me without warning, and I at him in all fairness, that was sometimes difficult to get out of.
I was, as I've often said, I was this kind of stupid one. And Josie, he was the one with the brains, and I listened to every word he said.
You know, you'd ask me about the meaning of a word, and Josie would delve deeply into the roots and derivatives thereof. He would give you the Latin origin, he'd break it up into its Greek or Latin origins in the most ridiculous fashion, rather along the lines of the word telephone, you know, telly I speak, phone through a tin tube. That kind of explanation would be a perfect Josieism. And Jack, by virtue of many of the situations, would at the same time appear to be thirsting for knowledge.
Because everything he said to me, it was right, and in the end, it was wrong.
As far as he was concerned, the greatest fount of knowledge that he ever knew was Josie.
Oh, yeah, mind, see that Mary Queen of Scotland? I meant to ask you about that. What was that big plaque that was in the middle of the flare there?
Well, that was where Rizzio fell.
I got a no surprise, I nearly tripped out at myself. I nearly went my elk to be on. Guns dangerous, you should have a wee sign, watch plaque. No. Plaque must be watched.
No, that's got all to do with events that took place in the 16th century.
Sure, Josie, 16th century.
Ah.
Was that AD or BC?
Oh, well, don't be stupid, they didn't have electricity in these days.
Kids, the youngsters that are watching it now, it's all new to them, you know. It's, although it's old comedy, it's new to them. They've never seen it before. It's quite true. I mean, they watch all these old films like the Laurel and Hardys and all that type of film, and they kind of find that very funny because it's stuff they've never heard before.
And I think a lot of our natural instincts and natures come into a lot of it. A lot of what shows, if a psychologist analysed what we do as the characters, I think you would find that he could also tell you what kind of people we were off stage.
But I think it's just the happy-go-lucky too, that the way it comes across, you know. I think it's the fun that we get out of anything at all. We get fun out of the least little thing.
The only warning that the other gets is a slight twinkle in the eye when they look, I mean, when he looks deeply into mine and I see his eyes twinkle. I know there's something coming, something I have not anticipated and don't expect, and I am left to get out of that.
I went to the doctor and he gave me a rummel hour with his periscope.
And what did the doctor say?
He was very definite. He said I had water on the brain.
Your brain dried up years ago.
Josie, it's true, he said I had water on the brain. What would you do for a thing like that?
Well, you could try a tap in the heat. Now, tonight, trainers, we thought we'd give you something in there.
No, Josie, no, we'll need to take this further.
Eh?
I'm not pleased with that answer.
Oh.
No, really. I just turned there and I give it a thought and I turn back and I says... It's just like that, you know.
Ah.
I hope the camera caught me. Ah. Now!
But the marvellous thing is that a lot of the material is frankly stuff that you could never sit down and think of. Not even in the best moments of inspiration could you think of a situation like that.
It was very clean humour, you know, and corny, and it suited everybody, kids and adults. And I think that's why it came across. You know, just too... guys that got on well together, the real Chinas. And that was a word that was used a lot in Glasgow, China. That's my China, you know. He's my China. Anybody was your China was your pal. Okay.
I'm a very different kind of man from Jack. I don't know whether anybody believes this or not, but I'm in fact rather a quiet kind of bloke. I don't rush around, I don't shout, and I don't... speak in that nervous way that Jack has. Jack enters this theatre, just to give you an example, and although there may be nobody in his sight, he starts talking. And you can hear him coming from the from his entrance at the door, and he talks away. And he'll go into his room and he's chatting away and he's getting himself all hyped up for the show. And, well, we've got to do this and we've got to put our makeup on, and there's nobody there at all.
in the Alhambra, there was a sketch Rikki was doing. We used to do sketches each, and then Francie and Josie together in the second half. And one of the sketches, Rikki was doing Napoleon, and I was to tag it as Francie, came on in my costume and my wig. And I was sitting in the dressing room, and I heard the word I thought was the finish of the sketch. I says, gosh, I'm off. So I rushed right out of the dressing room, right down the side of the stage, right through this door, onto the stage, and Rikki's sitting there as Napoleon. And he looked at me, he says, no, you're too early. I said, no now, he said, no, it's no now. So I had to go back out the door and wait for the finish, and I come back in and I says, right now. He says, ah, you're right now.
Running through a lot of the sketches and television shows that we did in those days, was this love of show business that they both had?
I used to sit up in the gallery here. As a boy, you know, about 14 years of age, 12 to 14, I came and watched all the shows in the gallery for about 6 months, saw them all here. Never thought the day would come when I'd actually play it. You know, it's a wonderful thing to do.
I think the material we use is distinctly Scottish. It's distinctly Glaswegian, in fact, because first of all, we are both Glaswegians, and particularly because since I write the material and all the songs, that most of which Jack sings, I may say, and therein is of course a wonderful advantage, because I can write a line which on paper people would say, you must be joking, you don't expect to get a laugh with that. But then, for example, if I write down, which I did and still do occasionally, sure Josie, sure Josie, sure, 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 you're not going to say that's very funny, but I happen to know how he's going to do it.
Well, let's give them a demonstration.
Sure, Josie, sure, Josie, sure, sure, sure.
Right, you be the bird.
Oh, no, I'm not being the bird.
Oh, come on, you be the bird.
You always make me the bird.
Well, you do it that well.
Well, I'll do it right, no day tomorrow night.
No. Get a couple of birds in tomorrow night.
Aye, sure. Get three in case one faints.
Ah, right.
I mean, Jack, to me, still is one of the funniest men I've ever seen in my life.
We're able to go out and still entertain with it, even to this day and age. Amazing, can't believe it.
So the undertaker, la-di-da-di-da, decided on a plan for daddy-da. He made another coffin, roughly 3 feet 2 by 1, just to take his life. La-di-da-di-da. Now you're reading on his tombstone, la-di-da-di-da, the son of la-di-da-di-da-di-da. Here lies his body, and in the next grave up but one, lies his body, daddy, daddy.